शलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमो ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामी इति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा। So welcome back to our second part of the Hare Kevalashtakam. So can we sing the fifth text? All of you have the sheets? Hari sadavaset tatra. Lord Hari always resides in those places yatra bhagavata jana, where the bhagavatas do. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I am Chaitanya Charan Das. Hare Krishna. Yes. Thank you. No problem. So, yatra bhagavata janaha. Wherever there are the devotees, those who are devoted to Bhagavan, they gayanti bhakti bhavena. They sing with devotion, Hare Naam Eva Kevalam. They sing the holy names of Lord Hari. So, Krishna resides where devotees chant the holy names. On the spiritual path, Krishna is not just our destination. He is also our companion. Say, suppose, if, say, from Australia, you're going to America to meet someone, and you never met that person before. You don't even know how that person looks. It is just going first time to meet that person, and then you are on your flight, and say there's a very, very important person, big person, very excited about meeting them. And then finally, when you reach there, you throughout the flight, you're waiting with excitement, and you reach there, knock on the door, and you open the door, and the door opens, and you see there, greeting you, is the same person who was sitting right next to you throughout your flight. But because you had not known that he was the person you were going to meet, so you did not realize. So like that, for us, Krishna is our destination. When we travel on the spiritual journey and the flight towards Krishna, when we reach the spiritual world, we will meet Krishna. But Krishna is not just a destination. Krishna is also our companion. Sarvasya chaham hrudi sannivishto. He is present in the hearts of every one of us. He's always there as a companion. But Krishna, although he is close to us, not only is Krishna close to us, he is closer than the closest person can ever be to us. Now, even if a person holds us in a tight embrace, that person cannot come as close to us as Krishna is eternally to us. So Krishna is close to us, but we are far away from him. Why is that? Krishna is close to us, but we are far away from him because we have turned away from him. Krishna bahirmukha jiva bhogavancha kare. Krishna bahirmukha. Our face is turned away from Krishna. At the same time, although we turn away from Krishna, Krishna doesn't turn away from us. He is there with us even now. And he always stays with us. Now there is nothing that anyone can ever do that can stop Krishna from loving them. You know, there's no sin, no offense, no action that anyone can ever do that can make Krishna say, you know, I'm fed up with this person, I'm leaving his heart, I'm giving up, going away. Krishna will never ever desert us. He's always there with us. And in that sense, we are never disqualified from bhakti. Now we may be unqualified for bhakti, but we are not disqualified from bhakti. Now unqualified means, yes, we don't have the qualification to participate. But disqualified, we are not allowed to participate only. That never happens. Krishna is always there with us. Krishna always offers us the opportunity to turn towards him. So if Krishna is present right now in our heart also, then what can we do to perceive his presence? The perception of Krishna depends largely on the tuning of our consciousness. Our consciousness needs to be tuned with the devotional frequency. Just like if we use FM radio, the sound vibration is going on, but if our receiver is not tuned, we don't get any of the sound. So similarly, right now our consciousness is not tuned. That's why our heart is focused on other things. Now we, on a practical level also, we experience sometimes if we are very interested in something, then we are only aware of that thing, and whatever else might be there, we don't even notice it. I sometimes say, if there's a cricket match is going on, and say people are mad for cricket, then sometimes, there's one devotee who was going to a shop to purchase some jewelry for the deities, and just outside that shop, there was a TV kept. And you know, to enter the and along with opposite that, there were people who were watching the TV. And the cricket match was going on. So, you know, to just enter the shop, you have to go in between the people who are watching and the TV. And these people were not ready to let anyone come even for one moment. They didn't want to miss the action for even one moment. So later this devotee told me that. He is saying that this is the reflection of the gopis. They don't want to miss Krishna's vision for even one moment. The gopis say that, oh, if our eyelids close for a few moments, we feel as if it is the end of the world. How can we be without Krishna's darshan for even one moment? Atatiyat bhavan ahanikananam trutiyugayate twama pashyatam kutila kuntalai. They say that when you go out and we can't see you, truti yugayate. Truti is a small fraction of a moment that seemed like a yuga. It seems like an intolerable millennium. So the point I'm making is that when we are interested in something, we become completely consumed in that and we lose awareness of other things. So just as this can happen, even when some things are perceivable, so there are 100 things which are perceivable, but if we are attracted to one thing, we focus only on that thing, we forget everything else. Similarly, what can happen is that although Krishna is present, because our consciousness is focused on the material level of reality, so we can't perceive Krishna right now. Then how can we access Krishna? That is through the association of devotees. So where devotees glorify Krishna, there in the experience of spiritual sound vibration, the experience of spiritual peace, spiritual joy, we get an experience of Krishna. And that experience of Krishna helps us progress gradually towards Him. So experience, now we talk about pratyaksha, anuman and shabda. These are the different pramanas. Now we see with our senses, that is pratyaksha. We infer with our mind, that is anuman. And we hear from scripture, that is shabda. Sanatana Goswami in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, yeah, the Goswamis explain that anubhav is the ultimate pramana. Anubhav, experience. What shabda says is true, but we have to experience it ourselves. Then it becomes true for us. We realize it to be true. We often say we have to get realizations. Now, what exactly is a realization? Realization simply means that which is a reality, we understand and accept it to be a reality. That which is a reality, when we understand and accept it as a reality, then it becomes our realization. So Krishna is present right now within our heart. Krishna is present right now as His holy name. But we don't realize that right now. But when we associate with devotees, and in the association of devotees, Krishna is glorified, Krishna's presence is invoked through that association, at that time, we start experiencing some mystical peace, some mystical joy. And that is the experience of Krishna's love for us at our level of reality. And in this way, as we start experiencing Krishna more and more and more, our consciousness starts getting spiritually elevated. And then our spiritual perception, our capacity for spiritual vision, our spiritual eyes, they awaken, they open. And then gradually we will see Krishna directly. But that journey begins with sound vibration. Not just sound vibration that is vibrated by devotees in a mood of devotion. So anybody can chant the holy names and that will give a benefit. But it depends on how much those who are chanting the holy names, they appreciate Krishna's presence in the holy name. Then that much they will chant with devotion, and when they chant that much with devotion, with esteem, with regard, with affection, that much Krishna manifests. And when Krishna manifests, not only are the singers benefited, not only are the reciters benefited, but also the hearers are benefited. So the value of association is that our devotion cumulatively invokes Krishna's presence. When we practice devotee, practice bhakti ourselves, the invocation of Krishna's presence depends on the potency of our own bhakti. But when we are in the association of devotees, then the cumulative devotional energy invokes and attracts Krishna's presence. And that's how we can experience Krishna's presence very powerfully in stimulating association. And there is a famous verse in the Purana which says, where Lord Vishnu is telling Narad Muni, Naham vasami vaikunthe yoginam hridayeshuva yatra gayanti madbhaktaha tatra tishthami Narada. So he says, Naham vasami vaikunthe, I am not residing in Vaikuntha. Yoginam hridayeshuva, nor am I in the hearts of the yogis. Then where am I? Yatra gayanti madbhaktaha, wherever my devotees are glorifying me, tatra tishthami Narada, there I am present. Now this is actually a rhetorical statement. Krishna is definitely present in Vaikuntha. And the yogis who meditate and they come to the advanced stages of meditation, when they come to Samadhi, they do perceive Krishna's presence over there also. But what Krishna is stressing by this statement is that in those places, we can't perceive Krishna's presence. Now Krishna is there in Vaikuntha, but how can we perceive it? Krishna is there in the hearts of the advanced yogis, but how can we perceive it? But when the devotees come together and glorify Krishna, yatra gayanti madbhakta tatra tishthami Narada. In the association of devotees, we can experience Krishna. And this experience of Krishna elevates us slowly towards raising our consciousness spiritually. When a baby is very small, just a newborn, at that time the infant's capacity to understand is very little. So the infant may not even understand, yeah, this is my mother and I'm on my mother's lap and my mother loves me. The infant doesn't understand anything. You know, the infant gets the mother's breast and just suckles it and gets milk. After the infant starts growing, then he or she starts understanding, oh, this is my mother and she loves me. And then as he goes further, then she starts understanding what all my mother is doing for me. So suppose that, say it's very cold and the baby is trembling. When the baby is trembling, shivering in the cold, so the mother sees that and the mother puts a blanket on the baby. And the baby is asleep and in the sleep only she is trembling. So she may not even understand, oh, this was my mother who came and my mother put the blanket on me. But what the baby experiences is comfort, warmth, security. Oh, I was feeling cold, now I'm not feeling cold. And then, as the baby keeps growing, then if the same thing happens later, then even in a semi-sleep state, she'll understand, oh, my mother must have put the blanket on me. That's how I am feeling warm. So that experience, what the mother is, the baby is not opened the eyes, and the baby has not actually seen the mother. But as she has grown up, and then for the baby, the experience of the blanket's warmth is the way the baby experiences the mother's love. Similarly, when we chant the holy names, when we try to absorb our consciousness in spiritual sound vibration, our eyes are closed. Like the sleeping baby, our eyes are closed. And that's why we can't perceive Krishna's presence. But if we immerse our consciousness in spiritual sound vibration, then we experience comfort, we experience relief from anxiety, from fear, we experience peace, we experience joy. So Krishna gives a comforting sense of security and satisfaction to our consciousness. And that satisfaction which we experience, that at our level, that is the experience of Krishna's love. And as we advance, just as the baby, as she grows, and the eyes will open and the baby will see the mother. So like that, as we keep growing, we will also realize Krishna's presence directly as we keep advancing spiritually. But right now, we need to use the philosophical intelligence to connect the experience of relief and joy in the chanting of Krishna's holy names with Krishna's love. Now, people can chant many different names, and any chant can give them a little relief. But the extent and the nature of the relief and the joy that comes through chanting of the holy names, that is not available through any other sound. And that is an indication that this is Krishna manifesting for us. And Krishna manifests in proportion to our devotion. Because when we have devotion, that devotion shows Krishna that we want him to manifest. And he reciprocates by manifesting. So when our devotion is not very strong, then we come in the association of devotees. And therein, by the cumulative force of devotion, we experience Krishna's presence. So that's why it says over here that wherever etra gayanti mad bhakta, wherever my devotees are singing my holy names, Krishna says, I am present. And here also in the Kevalashtakam, it is stated that that Hari is always present wherever his name is glorified.
Gayanti bhakti bhavena.
Kachartham Vismritam Ratnam. So, Ratna is a jewel, Kacha is glass. So if one mistakes a jewel to be just a piece of glass, and that is a great tragedy. And Aho Dukkham Maha Dukkham Dukkha Dukkataram Yataha. So it is good, better, best. It's superlative. So he's saying that it is a great sorrow, it is a great tragedy, in fact it's a catastrophe. There's no greater catastrophe than this, that somebody mistakes the jewel of the holy name to be just an ordinary sound vibration. Now, all of us have different conceptions of fortune, based on whatever our interest is, whatever inclination is, whatever our backgrounds are. Some people may think that wealth is fortune. Others may think that intelligence, learning is fortune. Others may think that strength is fortune. Others may think that beauty is fortune. So all of us can have different conceptions of fortune. And based on the conception of fortune, correspondingly, we also have our conceptions of misfortune. And if I lose this, this is a catastrophe. And at a material level, say if somebody is a surgeon and the person in an accident loses a hand, that's a catastrophe for the person. Because that is what the person is using for earning a living and has trained oneself for a lot. So just like what may be valuable for one person may not be seen as all that important for another person. So if a person is very expert in a particular thing, then whatever that person is expert and whatever is required for that expertise, that becomes the conception of wealth and treasure. When we come to spiritual life, material life, progress depends on wanting, on having or getting what we want. No, I want a bigger car, I want a bigger house, I want this, I want that. So if we have what we want, then that is material progress. Spiritual progress, on the other hand, is different. It depends not on having what we want, it depends on wanting what we have. We already have Krishna in our heart. We already have the holy name. We already have the association of devotees. But we don't appreciate it right now so much. So the process of spiritual growth is primarily a process of increasing appreciation of Krishna's various manifestations. Now, when we come in front of the deities, we offer obeisances. We bow down and offer obeisances. Actually, the original spirit in which the obeisances is done is, when the pure devotees come in front of Krishna, they are so ecstatic. Oh, my beloved Lord is right here in front of me. When they see them, just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he first time saw Jagannath, he was longing to see for months and years to see Jagannath. And finally, when he saw Jagannath, he just rushed forward and he wanted to embrace Jagannath. He couldn't even embrace. Before that, he fainted and he fell on the ground. So the pure devotees, when they see Krishna, his manifestation as the deity, they faint and fall in ecstasy. So we sadhakas, we can't faint. We are told at least fall. So fall down and offer obeisances. And gradually, by that act of submissive devotion, we'll get purified. So we do the external activities, and the advanced devotees, pure devotees also do the same activities. It is not that pure devotees are chanting some other esoteric mantra. They're also chanting the same Hare Krishna mantra. But they have far greater appreciation for the holy name. This is actually Krishna manifesting as the holy name. So spiritual advancement is primarily focused on more and more wanting what we have, valuing what we have, appreciating its value. And this comes firstly by philosophical education. When we study, when we understand the philosophy, we start understanding the glory of the holy name. And apart from philosophical education, it also comes by spiritual purification. As we become purified, then the glory of Krishna as the holy name starts manifesting to us. So suppose, this, there are three superlatives used, aho dukkham maha dukkham dukkha dukkha taram yataha. So it's bad, worse and worse, like that. A triple superlative is used over here. So to understand this, suppose a person is poor and a person is starving. That's sad. Suppose a person is wealthy, but because of carelessness, a person has lost all the wealth and so is starving. That is even more tragic. You had wealth already. Sometimes people, in the hope of getting a lot of money, invest carelessly in some shares which are unstable, and then they lose all the money. Or people get into lotteries, and when they just lose money in lotteries. Many times nowadays, parents, when they want to, they earn a lot and they want to give their inheritance to their children, but they don't trust their children. So they have legal deeds made by which, you know, my child cannot withdraw more than a particular amount of money every year. It's the children's own money, but they want them to withdraw it in a regulated way, otherwise they will squander all of it. So to have money and to just waste it, and then to be in poverty and to be starving and suffering, that is even worse. But suppose, you know, the parents have kept a great treasure in a treasury, and they told us, you know, before the parents pass away and give the inheritance, they told, I have kept the treasury over here in this chest. And the child forgets it. And so is starving. You know, so they have the money, but they've forgotten that the money is there. So, yes, I know there's a chest, something is there, and I don't know what is there. So to have the treasure and still be starving, that is the greatest tragedy. So for us, spiritually, that is our condition. No, Krishna is there with us right now. Not only is Krishna there with us, we have the opportunity also to connect with Krishna. We have also, at our level, in some small ways, experienced the joy of connection with Krishna. But still, we forget that there is so much spiritual fulfillment, there is so much spiritual joy available, and we look elsewhere for happiness. We look towards material things. So, kachayam vismritam ratnam. So the holy name is like a jewel, but we think this is just a glass, and we look for jewels somewhere else. Where can I find jewels? That is the greatest tragedy. And just as the children, they have to be told by someone, your parents have kept a great treasure for you in this chest. And the children have to, if some children are very small, now even a precious jewel might be there, they may think this is just a nice colorful stone. They may take the jewel and start playing, you know, catch with it. And if somebody sees this, they'll get a heart attack. This is a jewel, you fall, it breaks, you lose such a treasure. But so then somebody has to tell them what is the value. And not only that, they also have to grow up to realize its value. When they're very small, they don't realize the value also. So like that, at present, you know, we have to be told, repeatedly reminded, that what is the glory of the holy name. And not only that, we have to be reminded, we also have to grow up spiritually. So if we don't associate regularly with devotees, where we hear the glories of the holy name, there can be different kinds of association, and we hear different aspects of Krishna Bhakti, and that is all important. But especially, we can observe that if we don't hear regularly, then we'll find that our chanting starts becoming a burden. Why? Because if you're not hearing regularly, by default, our mind starts devaluing the holy name. Oh, I have to spend so much time, and I have chanted so many times. What has happened? Again, one more day I have to chant. So then, as the mind starts devaluing the holy name, then chanting starts appearing more and more like a word. Suppose somebody comes and tells, no, okay, there's this 20 kg weight, please carry this. I say, 20 kg, why should I carry it? Can't someone else carry it? We will feel it's a burden. But suppose the same person, this is a 20 kg gold. And the further you carry it, that much of the gold will be yours. Say, I'll carry as far as you want, you know. So, if we appreciate what is there, we are carrying, then the same thing, the weight is there, but it does not feel like a weight. But if we don't appreciate the value, we feel it's just a burden. So, sometimes some devotees chant 64 rounds, 128 rounds, 192 rounds. If somebody can chant like that, that's good. But we have to be honest with ourselves. No, am I really just absorbed in chanting, or am I just, you know, trying to meet some numbers, targets? It's good. Actually, having a particular commitment in quantity, it also forces us to bring quality. Because if we decide if I'm going to chant 16 rounds every day, then what happens? I have to spend 1.5-2 hours. And then if I'm not going to absorb myself in the holy name, if I'm not going to be attentive, then what will happen? Those 1.5 hours will just go waste. So then, I have two options. Nobody wants to waste time. Of course, we all waste time, but when we are wasting time, we don't think we are wasting time. When we get into illusion, we start doing something, we think this is important. This is what I should be doing. So we don't consciously think, oh, today I have a lot of time to waste. Let me find a new way to waste time. So we don't consciously ever go out wasting time. But based on our state of mind, certain things appear like a waste of time and certain things appear like a very valuable use of time. Whether that perception is true or false, that may vary according to person to person. But, so somebody who's a cricket fan, that person may think that watching cricket, that's a very valuable use of time. Chanting, that's a waste of time. So that's based on the state of awareness. Person not spiritually aware, so they think like that. But in our case, although we have spiritual knowledge, often, see, Maya, when she attacks devotees, he doesn't attack directly. It's not that Krishna, Maya doesn't come forward, you know, you give up Krishna and start doing sense gratification, start doing sensual activity. No. Yes, Krishna is important, but not so urgent. You know, yes, Krishna is important, but you don't have to keep it number one priority, you know. You can do later. So we start pushing Krishna down our priority list. And then just from the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, it goes down. It becomes invisible. We are still devotees, but there is no visible aspect of devotion within left within us. That's how we just are pushed down, pushed down, pushed down. So when we are chanting the holy names, when we are trying to commit, we commit ourselves. Okay, I'll chant for a particular amount of time. Say, I'm 1.5-2 hours, 16 rounds. Then if we are not attentive, then eventually we start feeling this is a waste of time. I'm getting nothing out of this. Why should I do this? At that time, we have two options. Either we bring in quality, or if you're not going to bring in quality, sooner or later, we'll give up the quantity. We think, why should I chant so much? And we'll give it up. So, now the quantity itself is not all that important. The quantity is impetus for us to bring about quality. So when we are chanting 16 rounds, we spend a little time in reminding ourselves about the glory of the holy name, about the importance of chanting. Then that helps us in focusing, in putting our heart in chanting. So there is a point of concentration and there is a circle of concentration. The point of concentration is the sound of the holy name. You just hear the sound of the holy name, gradually from that, remembrance of Krishna and the presence of Krishna will manifest. But to focus on the sound of the holy name is difficult. So just to focus on that one point is difficult. And when you can't focus on that one point, our mind goes all over the universe. So instead of letting it wander everywhere else, you know, we can create around the point of concentration a circle of concentration. Means if the mind wanders, okay, let it wander, but it can't stay on the sound of the holy name. Let it stay on something that is related to Krishna. So if you keep a picture of the deities in front of us, or if we write down the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, a nice attractive font, keep a printout of the written Hare Krishna Mahamantra, or write down some verse glorifying the holy name, or write down some sentence which strikingly reminds us about the glory of the holy name. Then, even if we can't focus on the holy name, our mind wanders here and there, it'll wander where? In that circle of concentration. And because those things are connected with Krishna, they will bring our mind back here. So, rather than letting the mind wander anywhere and everywhere, we give it scope for wandering. We give it some scope so that it doesn't feel like it's being choked or suppressed completely. But we give it a scope which is connected with Krishna, and gradually it comes back to Krishna. So here, one of the things which we can do is, in that circle of concentration, put things that remind us of the glory of the holy name. So something that reminds us of the glory of the holy name, that pushes us, yes, this is the same Krishna I'm associating with. This is the same all-attractive, all-powerful Lord, all-merciful, all-loving Lord that I'm associating with right now. And that way, this misfortune of mistaking the jewel to be a glass, that we can counter it. So we may not overnight realize that this is a jewel. But at the very least, based on our experience, based on our understanding, you know, yes, this holy name is not just an ordinary sound vibration. That much we can understand. We all experience something in chanting which ordinary sound doesn't provide. But based on that conviction, we can at least give it attention. And the more attention we give, the more we will see Krishna manifesting. The potency of Krishna will manifest as the holy name more and more. And so the point I was making earlier is that just chanting a lot of rounds, it's good, it's service to the holy name, but it may just become a burden over a period of time. And if somebody decides, I'll chant so many 64 rounds or so many rounds, on special days, if we feel inspired, that is fine. At the same time, while we are chanting, it is important to at least try to be attentive. Otherwise, we're chanting and thinking, you know, this holy name, it takes so much time. And if then actually, it is like, you know, sometimes you meet a person and, you know, they spend 15 minutes with you, but every second within this 15 minutes, they make it clear to you that they don't want to be there with you. Then, far from feeling happy with that meeting, we feel, why did I come here? Now, no one wants to feel unwanted. You know, then, if somebody is going to make us feel like that, you know, I don't want to be with you. You say, then why are you with me? Don't be with me, you know. They don't have the meeting at all. So, like that, if we make Krishna feel unwanted, then why are we invoking his presence? Of course, it is not that we shouldn't invoke Krishna's presence, but we shouldn't think that just chanting a lot of rounds is itself going to lead to spiritual advancement. Yes, 16 rounds the acharyas have given us, and that's why we chant them regularly. And more rounds, if we feel inspired, we can chant. But the important thing is not just to chant. It is to try at least to remember Krishna. It is to appreciate the value of Krishna, of the mercy of Krishna when he manifests as the holy name. And that way, when we appreciate, then Krishna gives us more and more appreciation. And then gradually we start realizing, this is Kachayam Vismritam Ratnam. There's a devotee who had gone to the Middle East. He was an American devotee. He was in the American army. And he was sent to the Middle East. He was in the American army before he became a devotee. And then, when he became a devotee, so he was thinking, should I stay in the army or should I just leave the job because this is all mundane politics? His spiritual master told him, no, if that is your job, you should continue it. So then he was sent to the Middle East. And then in the Middle East, they were all subject to sort of guerrilla attacks, ambush attacks at any moment. So everybody, all those American soldiers were quite stress-filled, fear-filled. So then he wrote his series of experiences, which he called the battlefield bhajans. So he wrote that I had been chanting the holy names for a long time, but in the war fields of the Middle East, I realized how wonderful the holy name is. So what he would do is, whenever he would have his gun and his helmet and all the green dress of the American soldier, and internally he would be chanting Krishna's names, not loudly, but in the mind he was chanting, or softly he would be chanting. And he felt that just the chanting gave me so much security. Several times there were ambush attacks, and he was very, with presence of mind, he guided all his, he was like a leader of a squadron. So he guided his team members to safety. And then one of his team members asked, sir, how do you stay so cool in such a situation? So then when I was about to answer the question, it struck me, he said, you know, this is why Krishna sent me here to the Middle East. You know, these other soldiers, they would never else have been interested in spirituality in Krishna. But now is my opportunity. So then he started telling them about how you're not the body or the soul. And at that time, they became interested. Because you know, they were on the verge of life or death. So at that time, if something gives meaning, they were interested in that. And they started studying that, they started hearing it. And so he was a good singer. So what he would do is, there itself in the camps, every week, he would have some bhajan sandhya sort of. In the army camp itself, they would have different kinds of entertainment. So here people would come and have spiritual entertainment. And then he told them about, so he had all these American soldiers, and before they would go for an operation, you know, he would give them a pep talk, reminding them, we are not the body or the soul. In life or death, we should remember God. And then, you know, all these soldiers, before they would go for war, he would sprinkle Gangajal on all of them.
The sacred water from the Ganga, and they would all go to battlefield.
So sometimes when there is great danger, at that time, we appreciate the value of the holy name. But we don't have to wait for danger to appreciate the value. If we use our intelligence and try to put our attention in the holy name, we can appreciate the glory of the holy name even without the danger. And that is the opportunity we have every day in our sadhana. Yes, in danger to appreciate Krishna is good. That is sukrutinaha. But to appreciate Krishna even when there is no danger, to connect with Krishna even when there is no danger, that is actually selfless love. And that selfless love is the most fulfilling for the heart. Yayatma suprasidati. The Bhagavatam says that when we practice bhakti, that is ahaituki anapratihata, unmotivated, uninterrupted, at that time there is suprasidati. The soul becomes fully satisfied. Okay, we can see this.
Me.
Bhakti is the path of sensory spirituality. Normally, the senses are considered to be the causes of entanglement. And so there are three broad approaches to the world. There's a path of karma, the path of jnana, and there's a path of bhakti. So in the path of karma, the idea is that by doing karma, by doing work in this world, we can improve things here and we can become happy. So most of the modern world is focused on the path of karma. And even science, with all its advancement, it is actually not jnana. It is also the path of karma. Why? Because science is used with all its knowledge primarily to try to enjoy this world. More scientific knowledge is used to build technology by which people want to become happy in this world. So in that sense, although there's a lot of intellectual component in science, but it is also part of karma. Then jnana in the Vedic context is always associated with vairagya. When we acquire knowledge, when we understand the true nature of this world, then we become detached from it. So in jnana, in the path of jnana, one understands that the very promises of pleasure in this world, they become the causes of misery. Just like a fish is attracted to a bait. And because of the attraction to the bait, the fish loses its life. Or for some mice are there in the house, some cheese is kept in the mice trap. And the cheese get that whatever they're attracted to, thinking that they will get pleasure, that is what causes their suffering and even their death. Similarly, we look at in this world, but many of the things that we think will give us pleasure, they are the causes of our suffering. So in jnana, one understands this, that the promises of pleasure in this world are deceptive. Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur said that this world is like a treacherous soil. If something appears to be smooth soil, we can walk calmly on it. If something appears slippery, then we'll be careful while walking on it. But something is slippery and appears smooth, then we will walk and we'll slip and fall. Now in Mahabharata, that's happened to Duryodhana in the Maya Sabha. He thought there is land over there, it was water over there. He just slipped and fell down. So like that, Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur, this world is treacherous soil. So where? Here, things are not the way they appear to be. And that's how we become entangled. So the path of jnana is that this world is a very, not just a dangerous place, it's a treacherous place. And therefore, there is aversion to this world. There is the aversion from the senses. The path of bhakti is different from jnana. Sometimes, if the renunciation aspect is overemphasized, then the renunciation becomes a greater focus than bhakti. And that becomes more a path of jnana than the path of bhakti. In bhakti, the focus is, in both karma and jnana, the focus is on the world only. And the world's relation with me. In karma, the world will give me so much pleasure. And in jnana, the world will cause me so much suffering. The focus is on the world or on me. Remember, today morning we talked about the three components of existence. What are they? Jagdish, Jiva, and Jagat. So the Lord, the soul, and the universe, and the world. So now in both of these, there is the focus only on Jiva and Jagat. So in karma, the idea is Jagat will give so much pleasure. And in jnana, Jagat will cause so much misery. But in bhakti, the eyes are not on the Jagat, but they are on Jagdish. So we don't look towards the world, we don't look away from the world, we look beyond the world. A devotee's eyes are fixed beyond the world towards Krishna. When the eyes are fixed on Krishna, that doesn't mean the devotee neglects the world. But devotee sees the world in connection with Krishna. And we use the things of this world in Krishna's service. And one of the things in this world is also our senses. So the same senses that can cause bondage. Now, if we use one of the obstacles in bhakti that Rupa Goswami talks about in the Upadeshamrut is prajalpa. Prajalpa is just mundane talk, unconnected with Krishna. That causes entanglement. But the same tongue can also open the door to liberation if it is used to glorify Krishna. So bhakti is not about rejecting the senses. It is about using the senses in the service of the Lord of the senses. One of the names of Krishna is Rishikesh, one who is the Lord of the senses. Rishika Isha. So devotees, time and again, as we see over here, there is prayer. There's the aspiration that let the senses constantly be engaged in Krishna's service. So let the ear always hear the holy names. Let the tongue always chant the holy names. Let me always use my senses to become absorbed in Krishna. Now we can, hypothetically speaking, remember Krishna anywhere and everywhere. But practically speaking, our consciousness is very much affected by our physical circumstances. Now, whatever we experience at the sensory level, that affects our consciousness. And that's why when we come to a temple, our consciousness tends to get spiritualized. Why? Because at a sensory level, we are exposed to spiritual stimuli. The subject of rasa is very elaborate. And later in our retreat, I'll talk about rasa. But rasa, in one of the things in the experience of rasa, is something called uddipan. Uddipan means spiritual stimulus. So that which stimulates our remembrance of Krishna, that is called uddipan. It's a simple definition. And the technical natyashastra, the technical definition also. But all of us may have different uddipanas. So for example, our thoughts about Krishna, our attraction to Krishna may be stimulated by different things. So for example, when I take darshan of the deities, if I don't recite any verses, I don't feel any connection with Krishna. So when I remember some verses, recollect those verses, recite those verses, then I meditate. This is the Lord who is glorified by these verses. He is present over here. That invokes the remembrance of Krishna more. So once I spoke this in a class, you know, by reciting verses, we can, you know, make our darshan of deities more devotional. And after some days, one devotee came and told me that when I try to take darshan of the deities and I recite verses, need to remember verses causes so much tension that whatever bhakti is there goes away. So actually, the shoe that fits one leg bites another leg. Different people have different leg sizes. So similarly, you know, what may be a uddipan for me may not be an uddipan for someone else. Somebody else may find that when we go in front of the deities and sing some Hare Krishna Mahamantra, a simple tune, that may attract. Or somebody else may just focus on how the Lord is decorated. And focus on each of the details of the Lord. And that gives them absorption in Krishna. So in bhakti, there is a standard process to follow. But there is also abundant room and necessity for individualization of that process. Individualization means, yes, we all have to remember Krishna, but how we remember Krishna, that will vary according to person. So while chanting the holy names, you know, if we can trigger some uddipan, that something that invokes the remembrance of Krishna for us, and then we chant the holy names, our chanting will become more prayerful, more devotional. And that can be reciting a verse, that can be singing a song, that can be just singing the Hare Krishna mantra in some musical tune that we like for a few times. And that way, the aspiration is here, that whatever it is that we normally use, whatever we are good at, whatever we normally use in our life, we use it for Krishna's service. So the senses, the same senses that are the path of cause of bondage can become the roadways to liberation in the path of bhakti. And that's why bhakti involves trying to spiritualize the environment. So that's why in the temple we will have beautiful decoration of the deities. And that is why Krishna doesn't need to be beautified by us. He's all attractive. But his all attractiveness is not manifested to us right now. So when we use our intelligence, our creativity in trying to serve Krishna by decorating the deities beautifully, then we are not only serving Krishna, but we are also making Krishna's beauty accessible at our level. And in that way, by spiritualizing our senses, by creating a spiritual environment as much as possible for our senses, then we can increase the possibility of remembering Krishna. So where whatever we are exposed to, we try to spiritualize those particular faculties. So if we are using computer, we can have as a wallpaper, as a screensaver, we can have Krishna's picture. If we are having some phone, if we feel inspired by a particular musical tune, we can have that tune in the phone. Whichever way we think about is conducive for us, we use that and create as much as possible of spiritual stimulus around us. So for us, it may not be practical to constantly chant the holy names, to constantly hear the holy names. We have so many other things to do in our life. But even while doing other things, we can try as much as possible to spiritualize our consciousness. And that way, as our senses are engaged more and more in Krishna-related stimuli. And although Krishna is in the heart, as I said, Krishna is close to us, but we are far away from him. That means Krishna is here, but we are turned like this. So, because we are turned like this, our vision, our consciousness is turned towards the physical world. And that's why to turn our consciousness towards Krishna, first we need to begin with manifestations of Krishna in the sensory world around us. And those manifestations attract us to Krishna. So somebody may come and somebody may just like to see beautiful statues. And that person comes to a temple and sees, oh, this is just a beautiful statue. But even with that initial appreciation, the person keeps coming to temple and say that, oh, here I experience something that I can never experience. I don't experience anywhere else. So gradually that difference will start sinking into the consciousness. And as that becomes more and more apparent, then even in the absence of the external stimuli, if we keep exposing ourselves to external stimuli related with Krishna, our consciousness becomes turned towards Krishna more and more. And then even when external stimuli are not there, that time also we will be able to remember Krishna. So the more we can use our own intelligence and our own creativity to find out how we can create as many devotional stimuli in our environment as possible. And that way we can increase the remembrance of Krishna. That way we can remind ourselves that yes, Krishna is the ultimate reality. Harer Naam Eva Kevalam. Thank you.
Yeah.
जगत सर्वम, जगत द होल यूनिवर्स, त्रुणीकृत्य, त्रुणीकृत्य इज मेक्स इट इनसिग्निफिकेंट लाइक अ ब्लेड ऑफ ग्रास. त्रुणीकृत्य जगत सर्वम राजते सकल परम. दिस होली नेम रूल्स ओवर द होल वर्ल्ड. राजते सकल परम एंड चिदानंदमयम शुद्धम. दिस इज filled with spiritual joy. Chidanandamayam. Anandamayam means filled with consciousness joy. Shuddham, supremely pure. Harirnameva kevalam. This is the holy name of the Lord. Holy name alone. Trinikritya jagat sarvam. The whole world becomes very tiny. Now what does this actually mean? There are many people who talk about positive thinking. I mentioned that briefly yesterday. The glass is half empty, see it as half full. And this is involving changing our perception. Okay, what when I see, what do I focus on in what I see? That is changing our perception. There's another thing is, so yes, it is always good to think positive, but bhakti is not just about seeing positive. It's not just about changing our perception. Hare Krishna, yeah. It is not just about changing our perception. Is it too loud? Some echo is there? So it is also, bhakti is also about changing our perspective. Remember yesterday I mentioned that? No, there is a difference between a one-story house and a 100-story skyscraper. That difference from the ground is huge. But if you are in an airplane high above, then the difference is not much. You will not even notice that. So there, it's not just a change of perception, it's a change of perspective. So perception means, when we see, change of perception means, in whatever we see, what do we focus on? Change of perspective means, from where we see. So, bhakti is about change of perspective. Because when we understand, I am not the body, I am the soul, then that completely shifts our perspective. Okay, what is important in my life? What will bring me true happiness? That is change of perspective. But bhakti is actually more than change of perspective also. It is change of reference. Change of reference means, if you travel in the airplane, and if the airplane is flying, if the plane is flying through the sky, then if you're sitting there near the window, near a seat from which you can see the plane, the plane sometimes appears as the wing. You can see the wing stretched out. It sometimes appears in the sky as if the plane is moving very, very slowly. It's like almost as if in slow motion, not moving at all. Why is that? Now if in some airplanes they have the details, so it may be 500 kilometers per hour it may be moving. But it appears as if it is moving very slowly. So why does it appear like that? Because, you know, the motion is seen relative to the reference. So the sky is vast, and as compared to the vastness of the sky, even the huge motion, the very fast motion, appears to be very less. But then as the plane starts coming closer and closer to the ground, then we see how fast roads and homes are just whizzing by. Then we see, oh, this is moving so fast. So our perception, what we see is determined by our reference also. So that we are moving forwards, we don't realize it when we are in the sky. When our reference for trying to assess the motion of the sky, it appears as if there is very little motion. But when our reference is the ground, we see there is a lot of motion. So for most people, the reference in everything is this world. And that's why all the changes that happen in this world are, you are very important, are very, very important, you know. There are people who are just hooked to the news. And nowadays with breaking news coming, breaking news keep breaking at every moment. So people can get just consumed by the news. There's one sociologist, he said that, what is news? News is essentially old things happening to new people. The same things are happening, but they're happening to new people. Of course, I'm not saying that we should stay ignorant about news. The point I'm making is that when our reference is this world, things that happen in this world seem to matter a lot for us. In fact, even when people worship God, now Krishna, he performs his pastimes in the spiritual world, and he plays his flute to invite us to be with him in the spiritual world. Many times people go to different temples, and they sometimes come to Krishna temple, they say that, you know, other temples, God is giving me blessings. But here Krishna, he never gives any blessings, you know. He seems lost to his own world. He's playing his, you'll hardly ever see Krishna with a hand raised in blessing. It is not that Krishna is not blessing us. Krishna's blessing is not that we try to be happy over here. Krishna's blessing is he's playing his flute. And just as by playing his flute, he invited gopis to come and participate in the Rasleela. Like that, Krishna is playing his flute to invite us to his abode for joining his pastimes. But when our reference is the material world, you know, our purpose is that Krishna should help us perform pastimes here.
Yeah, I want to perform pastimes and Krishna should help me in that. So this is, of course, it's good that we are connected with Krishna in some way. But with this reference point, we cannot get much taste in bhakti. Because bhakti is transcendental. And if our reference point is the world, then what happens in the world affects us too much. And then we can't get the taste in bhakti, which is actually meant to raise our consciousness about the world. So the more we absorb ourselves in Krishna, through study, through worship, through chanting, through association, gradually our reference point changes. Our reference point changes. And then, when that reference point changes, then in relationship with Krishna, even the material things that are very big, they don't agitate us so much. Yes, the Trunikrutta Jagat Sarvam. That means the world becomes like a blade of grass. That doesn't mean that we don't care for the world, but that we don't consider ups and downs in the world to be catastrophic. We don't think that changing things in the world alone will make me happy. Changing our consciousness becomes more important for us. So, Vishla Prabhupada was in America, he was traveling various parts and he was preaching. So he came somewhere to a city which is quite close to Washington. And then Prabhupada said, at the start of his lecture, he said, you know, now I have come in this remote corner of the world trying to share Krishna's message. So the people in the remote corner, you know, people think that America is the center of the world. Not only America think they're the center of the world, they think the world begins and ends from the East Coast to the West Coast. So, you know, they thought, what do you mean remote corner of the world? But for Srila Prabhupada, you know, Mayapur was the center of the world. You know, that's where Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had descended. And then when Prabhupada first came to Mayapur, and after a lot of struggle, he got land over there. And when they got the land, what they got at that time was just, you know, completely remote. Prabhupada went to that land with some of the Malakrishna Maharaj, Jayapataka Maharaj, and he told the devotees, small group there, this will be our international headquarters. And the devotees looked around. They say, not a single human being anywhere. All around was simply overgrown sugarcane fields, you know. Say, Prabhupada, this remote corner of the will be our headquarters. Prabhupada said, you have material vision. This is the place where Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu descended. This is the place where the Yuga Avatar appeared. And this is where the Yuga Dharma is going to be propagated. So, this is the spiritual headquarters of the world. This is where we will have our headquarters. And devotees worked very hard. Now there's a beautiful spiritual community and city coming up in Mayapur. So, from a devotee's perspective, because Krishna is the center,
So everything else is seen with that reference point. So America may be geopolitically the most important part of the world. It may be the center of the world. But a devotee does not consider that as the center of the world. And similarly, in our spiritual life, as we keep practicing bhakti more and more, the worldly ups and downs, they will not have so much agitation for us. They will not cause so much either excitement or agitation. One of the things Krishna repeatedly talks about in the Bhagavad Gita is, na praharishet priyam prapya, no dvijet prapya cha priyam. He says, when somebody gets good, one doesn't jump up and down in delight. And when something bad happens, one doesn't sink into despair. Right? Because sthira buddhi asammoodho brahma vid brahmani sthitaha. Sthira buddhi, the intelligence is fixed. One is situated in spiritual realization. So we may not be situated in the spiritual realization right now. But if we take shelter of the holy name, take shelter of Krishna in his various manifestations, then we will experience this. The same thing, it may appear like a big catastrophe to us. And if you start chanting the holy name, you start remembering Krishna, we will start feeling calmer. We'll start feeling, gaining perspective. Yes, this is an issue and I have to deal with it. But there is a difference between, Prabhupada writes in the purport, a devotee may be perplexed, but a devotee is never discouraged. What that means is, perplexed means sometimes life may present us a situation that we don't know what to do. Should I do this or should I do that? Should I take a job here or there? Should I do this or do that? There's so many decisions we have to take, and sometimes it may not be clear what decision we should take. A devotee can be perplexed, but a devotee is never discouraged. Discouraged means that a devotee doesn't think, what is the use of doing anything? Devotee is confident that, yes, I have to keep serving Krishna. How I will serve him, that may not be clear to me right now. Let me just take one step forward, and gradually things will become clearer. So often, you know, faith means that we take one step forward even when the full path is not clear. Even the full path is not clear, just take one step forward, and as we keep taking one step forward, the next step will become clear. The next step will become clear and we'll keep moving forwards. So if we keep our eyes fixed on the world, then we cannot keep our heart fixed on Krishna. If we keep our eyes fixed on the world, our heart will also go towards the world. If we keep our eyes fixed on Krishna, then not only will our heart be fixed on Krishna, but also we will be able to deal with the ups and downs of life more maturely. Many times, whenever a problem comes in our life, you know, our response to the problem makes it a bigger problem. Just like, suppose somebody falls sick. Somebody says that person is going for a picnic, and a whole group is going for a picnic. And just before the picnic, this person gets a flu, and the person is lying in bed. Now, at that time, the mind eats up, you know, oh, I could have gone to the picnic, I could have been enjoying. Now, physically speaking, if the medicine is taken at that time, physically there may not be much pain. It's just weakness is there, one has to rest. But in the mind, there is resentment. Why did this happen? And that resentment of reality often hurts more than reality. You know, okay, going to the picnic, not going to the picnic, it's you miss something. But that resentment of reality eats us up a lot. And that happens, why? Because within our frame of reference, we may think that the only enjoyment I have is going for the picnic. And I didn't have that enjoyment, then I missed something. But if we are connected with Krishna, if you're devoted to Krishna, then Krishna is ever available for us, ever available for us. And when we connect with Krishna, this resentment of reality, which actually hurts us a lot, that can be cut down substantially. And that way, we can decrease our misery even when there are problems. Now, problems can't be avoided in life. But sometimes our attitude towards problems, our response towards problems, that makes it a much bigger problem. And when we have something other than the world and its objects to think about, to focus our heart on, then the world's problems don't trouble us so much. And as a devotee can be concerned about things without being disturbed by things. To not be concerned at all will be irresponsible. But to be disturbed will often impede our capacity to do anything constructive. So by taking shelter of Krishna, we can be concerned but not be disturbed. Because the world will not be at the center of our vision. It will be Krishna who will be at the center, and we will be able to respond to the themes of this world appropriately. So Chidanandamayam Shuddham, that Krishna, that his holy name, Chidanandamayam. There are many things in this world which are attractive, but nothing is purely Anandamay. Many things which give pleasure, but they give pleasure for some time, and afterward that pleasure, they say there is a law of diminishing returns. You know, if I eat first gulab jamun, delicious. Second gulab jamun, good. Third gulab jamun, yes. Fourth gulab jamun, you also take something.
So that you also take something is not because we are so selfless. That is because now that taste is not all that much there. And if you are forced to eat 10 or 15 gulab jamuns, then, you know, I say, no, I don't want anything more.
So in material life, there's a law of diminishing returns. But in bhakti, Krishna is fully Anandamay. And as we become purified, we start realizing that Anandamay more and more and more. And thus, Purnamritam, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, in the chanting of the holy names, that it is complete nectar. And that nectar we can relish as we become more and more purified. So although we don't have the taste right now, we can, by hearing from the great saints, remember and get the inspiration that this is what awaits us ahead. This is what awaits us ahead. And by that we can take inspiration and keep moving onwards in our life. So usually, if we feel, sometimes the mind can work in different ways. The mind can say, hey, you know, yes, all this is very nice, but this is so far away, you know. When will I get this kind of taste for the holy name? I'm never going to get it. Yes, if we get discouraged thinking how far away the pure state is, then we can turn back and look at how far we have come. Now, if we have been practicing bhakti for a few years, and if we think at our life before we started practicing bhakti, now we would probably never have thought that we would be following the four regulative principles, we'd be chanting the holy names, we'd be devoting ourselves to Krishna. So by Krishna's mercy, we have already come a long distance. You know, if Krishna's mercy had not been there, we would not have come all this far also. So if we start feeling discouraged, thinking that we are so far ahead to go, we can look back and see how far Krishna has already brought us. And actually, it is not that we have determinedly come. It is, despite our determinedly resisting, Krishna has brought us so far. So if Krishna has brought us so far, Krishna will take us all the way ahead also. And if we just keep faith, you know, it's like, as I said, if we just keep faith, Krishna will keep moving us forward, forward, forward. And this state which appears very lofty and inaccessible, that will become slowly and surely more and more accessible. So in bhakti, the process is evolutionary, but the result is revolutionary. The process is evolutionary. Every day we chant, we see nothing is happening. You know, yesterday I chanted, today I chanted, tomorrow I chanted, what is happening? But if you look at over our life, there's a radical transformation that happens. And that revolution happens not through a sudden change. It's not that suddenly one day we wake up and Krishna is standing in front of us. You know, that may not happen immediately. But as we become purified, as our frame of reference changes, then the reality and the sweetness of Krishna becomes more and more of an ever-present reality for us. And thus, even in this world, we can experience the eternal joy of bhakti. Prabhupada writes in the 5.29 purport of Bhagavad Gita that bhakti is invoking the spiritual world in the material world, experiencing Krishna in this world itself. And as we become more and more absorbed in bhakti, we can experience Krishna here itself.
Chidananda. Shine. Jeevananda Mayam Shubham.
Shri Hari Namashtakam ki. Shri Hari Nam Prabhu ki. Shri Hari Nam Sankirtan ki. Jai Gaur Premanande. So, does anyone have any questions? We'll have a short QA here. Yeah. Yes, Prabhu.
Sometimes, like, we struggle even by chanting, we might kind of fumble or pronouncing the holy name as well as the calibrate your brain. So, given that, of course, with all the disturbances around, all the other disturbances, you can become discouraged. How do you improve yourself there? How do you define that?
Question is that, sometimes when we chant the holy names, we may not pronounce properly. And while dealing with various problems in the world, this improper pronunciation becomes a further problem and it becomes discouraging. How to deal with that? Firstly, now pronunciation is not the most important thing in devotion. The important thing is the devotional intention. So if occasionally there is a mispronunciation, it is not, Krishna is not a fault-finding God. You know, He's not there to catch us when we do wrong. He's there to catch us when we fall. Krishna is not there to catch us when we do wrong. He's there to catch us when we fall. So, first of all, we recognize that devotion can be expressed even through an improper pronunciation. That is not a problem. At the same time, when we want to serve Krishna, we want to serve Him in the best possible way. So even when we chant His holy names, we try as much as possible to chant clearly. And sometimes we may do a recording of our own chanting to see if we are mispronouncing, where we are mispronouncing. And by that we can correct. Okay, this is when, maybe when I start thinking about something, I'm mispronounced, or when I'm rushing and trying to complete the rounds very quickly in some time limit, I mispronounce. And for pronunciation also, if we find that usually, maybe sometimes the last Hare gets missed out, because there are three Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, then Hare. The three Rams, three Hare may sometimes become one or two. So we can find out what is the mispronunciation and gradually work toward that. If it seems like too much of a task, then we can make it gradually. Say if you're chanting 16 rounds and a habit of mispronunciation has been developed somehow, then at least some rounds we consciously take care that we pronounce properly, even if that requires a little more time. But suppose, say, if we are mispronouncing and we are chanting every round in 5 or 6 minutes, and if we have to pronounce clearly, it takes 10 minutes, then the mental burden becomes so much. How can I spend so much time? Then, we start becoming offensive towards the holy name. Why is it taking so much time? So at that time, we may decide, at least we should try to correct the habit. So at least 1, 2, 4 rounds, I will chant with careful pronunciation. Remaining also, it's not that I'll be intentionally careless, but if there's a default habit, I may not be able to invest so much energy in countering that at that stage. But those 4 rounds also, few rounds, whatever we do carefully, if we do that gradually, that habit of clear pronunciation will pass over to others. To the other rounds also. And another thing is that pronunciation is also relative. That means, now we may ourselves pronounce a word clearly, but someone else may say, I can't hear this word being pronounced. So if that is happening, then we have to ourselves record and check it. It shouldn't be that we are enunciating the words ourselves, but because they are being enunciated in such a way that others are not able to hear it, others say that you are not pronouncing properly. So introspect and check it properly. There's no need to be very discouraged. No matter whatever happens, there is actually the biggest problem in bhakti is discouragement. If we don't get discouraged, if we keep moving onwards, doing what we can, Krishna will help us to do what we can't do. But when we become discouraged, we don't do even what we can do. And then Krishna will not force things upon us. Then He will not help us directly. He will not intervene with us. So, first of all, find what is the problem, what is the cause of the problem, and then take practical, manageable steps to gradually correct it. And when we get discouraged, we should know that anything, normally we think of temptation as lust, anger, greed, and these things as temptations. So we usually think that Krishna is here, if something takes me away from Krishna, that is temptation. But actually, that is not the only definition of temptation. Anything that comes between us and Krishna, that is also temptation. So, discouragement can also be a temptation. If discouragement stops us going towards Krishna, then we should know this is... So actually how it works is that the same mind which makes us do a wrong thing, then afterward the same mind becomes a judge and starts saying, you are such a fool, you know. Why did you do this wrong thing? So the same mind, it's like, you know, the same mind is the criminal, and then after it commits the crime, after it makes us commit the crime, then it becomes a judge and sentences us. So when this happens, this is like a dangerous double role of the mind. So at that time, we shouldn't listen to the mind. Anything that discourages us, we should recognize this is a temptation and not pay attention to it. So yes, there are different kinds of sources, different sources of discouragement. But whatever it is, if there is something discouraging us, we move away from it, move towards something which encourages us. That is not to deny or hide our faults, but we cannot deal with all our faults at the same time. We have one fault, one problem, we slowly overcome step by step. So discouragement is also temptation, and it needs to be intelligently resisted. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Ashish Prabhu. So this world is so vast and the temptations are so many, the illusory ocean is so big, so how can we, what is the hope that we can go across this ocean? Our hope is Krishna. Now devotee may be helpless, but a devotee is never hopeless. Sometimes there may be a situation where there seems to be no solution. So we may feel that there's no help, but there is always hope because Krishna is still with us. Madruk prapanna pashupasha vimokshanaya muktaya bhuri karunaya namo layaya. So Gajendra prays that, my dear Lord, you are Madruk. Please have mercy on me and liberate me from this animal body in which I caught. Pashupasha vimokshanaya. Liberate me from this body. And he says, why should you liberate? He says, muktaya, you are yourself free. And the Lord may say that, yes, I am free, but you are bound by your own karuna, your own karma. That's, you deserve it. He says, but bhuri karunaya, you are extremely merciful, O Lord. So even if somebody is undeserving, you will give mercy to that person. And the Lord may say, I gave you mercy so many times, you kept neglecting it. So he says, alayaya, my dear Lord, you never get tired of giving mercy. So, please don't get tired. Please keep giving me your mercy. Please liberate me. So yes, we have gone through millions of lifetimes. That is true. But it's also true that Krishna has gone through with us on millions of lifetimes. So, Krishna has not given up on us for millions of lifetimes. Why should we think of giving up in only one lifetime? You know, in this life, we keep practicing bhakti. Krishna is there to help us. And as I said, the devotees, if our focus is on the temptations to be overcome, then sooner or later we will be overcome. But if our focus is on Krishna, who is beyond the temptations? Who can lift us beyond the temptations? Krishna says, Tesham aham samuddharta mrityu samsara sagarat bhavami na chirat partha mayyaveshita chetasam. In 12.67, in the Bhagavad Gita, he says that, na chirat parth, if you fix your consciousness on me, soon, without much delay, I'll liberate you from material existence. So Krishna is our hope. And when we feel that there are big problems and there is big discouragement happening, then we need to associate with those who will encourage us. We need to have some friends who see the potential within us and who give us encouragement and positivity. You know, Sita, when Sita was abducted by Ravana, it was month after month after month, it was just going on and on. And at one time, one of the demons, it was a sorcerer, it was a magician in Ravana's army, Vidujvaya, he made a effigy of Ram and he cut off the head. And then Ravana came there and he said, "You were so proud that Ram will come and rescue you. Just see, I didn't even have to fight. My demon went and killed him. And he threw the beheaded the head and the corpse." Sita was shattered. She fainted over there. And when she came back to consciousness, you know, Ravana was jeering at her. And she looked at it and she said, "Oh, the astrologers had said that I would never be a widow. And alas, they have gone wrong." She just said, crying bitterly. And she said, "Just get a funeral pyre. I will die with my lord." Ravana said, "What happened?" He thought she will come to me, but instead of coming to me, she's just getting some grief. He said, "I don't want to tolerate this woman crying." So he says, "He'll come to her senses later." He just went away from there. So at that time, Vibhishana's wife came over there. And Sarama, she said, she consoled Sita. She told her, "This is all an illusion." He says, "Ram is even now building a bridge and coming across." And when Sita heard that, she became so late. She became increased. She looked at the carefully at the form of Ram. She said, "Yes, this is not my lord." And she recognized this is actually an illusion. So sometimes our mind creates various kinds of illusions which can shake or even shatter our morale. So at that time, we need association that encourages us. So not just association. See, what happens is devotees also who are guiding us, they have to be sensitive. Sometimes when a person is discouraged, at that time, we need to be encouraged. But if somebody is discouraged and we discourage them further at that time, that is a disservice. Now, there is Prabhupada was so expert. One time one devotee wrote to him and he said that, "Prabhupada, I want to assist you in saving fallen souls all over the world." And Prabhupada wrote back, he said, "Yes, it is good to save the whole world, but first we should save ourselves." And so if somebody is overambitious, then Prabhupada calmed him down. Another time, another devotee wrote to Prabhupada, "You know, I have so many anarthas. I am utterly useless. What can I do for you, Prabhupada?" So Prabhupada wrote back in a letter, "I need many useless souls like you who can help me in saving all the souls all over the world." So Prabhupada, he was expert, depending on the mood. So if somebody is discouraged, at that time, the devotees around should take it as a responsibility to encourage that person. So all of us will stumble, all of us will sometimes fall, and we all need association that will encourage us. And we ourselves try to fix our focus on Krishna, and rather than on the problems that are there, the conditionings, the temptations, and also we strive to associate with those who help us fix our vision on Krishna. Okay? Thank you.